yeah, thank you very much to the organizers, of course, for putting this wonderful workshop together and giving me the opportunity to speak here, and in particular to Tuan, I think, who did a lot of work, as I heard. So contrary to the previous speakers, I also got an assigned title, but I didn't commit the mistake in asking of what I'm actually supposed to talk about. I just took this super broad title and ran with it. So here's what I came up with. Cosmology, inflation, it's very closely tied to experiments. So I have kind of an introduction that reviews inflation in general, since it's also tailored to grad students, and discusses the current observational results, BICEP, probably everybody heard what happened there. Is it all dust? We don't know. So I will review that in an introduction. Then I'm kind of a string theorist at heart, so I want to discuss model building, what are the challenges and the advantages. So I think as string theorists, we bring something to the table, a UV complete theory of quantum gravity that is needed and that really nobody else has. So we are really needed to understand these experiments. So this is a big plus, but there are also challenges. Then understand the next meeting is February 2017 maybe. So I want to review three classes of models that are currently being tested that might be excluded in 2 years, might be not, might be constrained much more than they are already, but that are currently relevant for experiments and that are connected, two of them to string theory and one to supergravity. So that will be this part. And then I felt I kind of did my part in reviewing the subject. I wanted to talk about something that is exciting right now and that is new and that started more or less a year ago, and that is related to what's called the nilpotent chiral superfield, and I'll tell you how that is connected to, in particular, the sitter vacuum and cosmology, and then I have a conclusion. So I should also say, if at any point something is unclear or something is wrong, just interrupt me, make it a little bit more interactive. So let me start with the introduction. Our universe underwent a phase of inflation, more or less 10 to the minus 35 seconds of its large field, high scale inflation after the Big Bang. And we can't really probe that. This is shown in this picture, which is why I showed it. They're kind of gravity waves and they travel all the way to us now here. We cannot really detect this. And in Vienna, we had some European Physical Society meeting, and I mean, the people that detect gravity waves, they don't even claim that will be possible in the future. It's not clear that it will never be possible, but it's certainly out of reach right now. What might be possible one day, which is not sketched here, we can get a snapshot maybe 1 second after the universe, after the Big Bang, which is via a neutrino background. It's not shown here. But so after 1 second after the Big Bang, neutrinos decouple and they stream freely and they form a neutrino background, microwave background. So it's slightly colder than the cosmic micro background, it's certainly much older, and there at least people that detect neutrinos say it's not completely out of reach. But for now, and nobody's detecting it, nobody's trying to detect it right now, what people are detecting, however, is this cosmic microwave background, and that originated 380,000 years after the Big Bang, at the moment when protons and electrons combined to form neutral hydrogen, and then light could just stream freely through the universe, and we are looking at this light. And since it's an overview talk, I felt compelled to mention this CMB was discovered 50 years ago, so we have a big birthday this year. Penzias and Wilson, they were looking at the sky with their big antenna, and they had this kind of random noise in there, and then they found some pigeons nesting. You probably heard the story, so they climbed in there, and they got the pigeons out, they cleaned all the bird poop, and the noise was still there. So they published this paper, and at the same time, people at Princeton, they predicted that theoretically you would see it, and they started already building some kind of antenna on their building. But then they got scooped, and this was then the Nobel Prize in 1917-8. Now, the black body spectrum wasn't really precisely measured, the CMB spectrum, until 1989 by the COBE satellite. The COBE satellite measured this remnant spectrum, and it's a perfect black body, the best ever observed in nature. So the error bars are totally indistinguishable from the theoretical curve. It's very precise. It has a temperature of 2.725 Kelvin, and it fills essentially the entire sky. And this was a Nobel Prize in 2006 to two of the PIs of Kobe. Now, once people discovered the black body spectrum, immediately a problem became apparent, because essentially if you look in one direction and look in the other direction, you see the same 2.75 Kelvin black body spectrum. So this is like time and space diagram simply, and we see the surface 380,000 years ago. And the surface is totally uniform up to four digits here. Now if you dial time back a little bit further until you hit the initial singularity, the Big Bang, you get these tiny small light cones. And if you flip those around, you see some immediate problems. So any kind of, sorry. any kind of point can only talk to a very small part of this surface where the CMB photons were emitted, 380,000 years. So how can all these points know that they have exactly the same temperature? And this is the horizon problem. Essentially, the causally connected regions should only span 1.6 degrees, roughly the size of the moon, a little bigger. And we have like 10,000 disconnected patches in the sky, and they all have exactly the same temperature. And that's a big question, why do they all have the same temperature? And then Goose, Linde, Steinhardt, Albrecht, they developed this idea of inflation. It's essentially some kind of exponential expansion of space at a very early time. This is the equation, and I have in two slides a picture, which I always like better than equations, particularly for talks. Now, the measurements today are much more precise, and what they actually discovered, these four-digit temperature is everywhere the same, but then on the fifth digit you start seeing a lot of variation. You see these kind of fluctuations, and you probably have seen it, and it looks like totally random noise. And if you do a Fourier analysis of these fluctuations, you find they are actually not random. They have a very particular kind of shape or behavior, and exactly that is predicted by inflation. So these were discovered after inflation was invented. So it's not a post-diction, like solving the horizon problem or something. This is a prediction, actually. So it predates the discovery, and inflation made the prediction. So how does inflation work? Inflation essentially takes a very tiny patch, like 10 to the minus 35 seconds after the Big Bang, roughly, and then it expands it by an insanely huge factor, e to the 60 maybe, 10 to the 26. And it expands it so much that essentially all these kind of photons or this whole surface can be easily in causal contact. And by that, it explains that they all have the same average temperature, 2.725. But it also explains all these tiny dots in there. So it's a great success. It's a beautiful theory, and it's rather simple. So to explain all these patterns, essentially what we need is just one scalar field. All observations are consistent with this simple slow roll scalar field model. So the idea is you have some scalar field that sits in some kind of potential, and it slowly rolls down to some kind of minimum, and then it oscillates there and settles into this minimum. And if you couple general relativity to the scalar field, what you find is that this energy momentum tensor, if the scalar field is homogeneous in space, it takes this simple form with some rho and p. And rho and p are given by these quantities, where this is a time derivative. So there are no space derivatives. I assume it's homogeneous. If there are space derivatives, they actually die out during inflation, during the expansion, the stretching. And what people noticed is that if this phi dot is much smaller than the actual value, so if this scalar field grows very slowly, then this behaves exactly like a cosmological constant, rho equals minus p. So this leads then to an exponential expansion of the universe. And likewise, if the scalar field settles here, and this is non-zero, but rather slightly above, this scalar field could also serve as the cosmological constant that we need today, that is 70% of the energy density of our current universe. So within this simple model, kind of, we can explain inflation and the late time acceleration of our universe. And the scalar field is a quantum field, so if you analyze it like a quantum field, you find that there are small fluctuations And these small fluctuations lead to these tiny temperature variations that have been observed in this cosmic microwave background. Now, for inflation to work, we need essentially two parameters, so-called slow road parameters, to be small. One is the first derivative, essentially, is epsilon v, and the other one is the second derivative. And both of those have to be small at some time 50 to 60 e4. So it means before the universe expands by an additional, what it rolls here, factor e to the 50 or e to the 60. And what experimentalists can actually tell us for these simple models is what should be this value for epsilon and beta, or at least they can constrain it. And that then constrains the potential, it constrains our models, and it tells us which models to build, which models not to build, which models might be realized in nature. So here I wrote down epsilon and eta again. And I showed you an experimental plot from the Planck satellite 2015. And there are a lot of dots, which I will go to in later. What's more important right now are these kind of exclusion curves. So that are the experimental results. And what's plotted here on the axis is R, which is 16 times epsilon in these slow roll models, and then S, which is some combination of epsilon and eta. And then depending on whether you take the Planck satellite, whether you combine it with bicep keck, or baryon acoustic oscillation, you get different curves of likelihood for these parameters. So this dark blue is for 1 sigma, and the light blue is a 2 sigma region. And then you can put predictions from different models in here, and you can see how they measure up. So some are very unlikely, if they are very far in the white. If they are here in the center, they are much more likely. But I mean, if you ask experiments, this wouldn't be excluded. They would be hesitant to say something is excluded. 2 sigma is 95%. Maybe this is close to 3 sigma. It's a per mil level. So we have to take it with some caution. And I'll discuss a couple of these models later. Now, this R value, which I just had there on the y-axis, it's related to the slow roll parameter. It's just 16 times epsilon v. And as you might have seen, it's currently constrained to be around order 0.1. Why is that exciting? Why should we care about this range? I mean, experiments constrain and they keep constraining it. Why is this particular range interesting? So that's the point I want to make. We know for slow roll, epsilon has to be very small compared to 1, because otherwise the scalar field will roll very fast. We don't get inflation. So for it to roll slow, epsilon has to be very smaller than 1. And R is 16 times epsilon. So now the question is, how small should epsilon be? For example, R is currently constrained to be smaller than 0.1. That tells you then directly that this potential we are looking at has the first derivative whose value is 0.1 times V in natural Planck units. If R would be 10 to the minus 3, then it would be more fine-tuned. So here at the percent level, here at the 10% level. So it seems kind of a natural range where you don't have to tune V prime compared to V all that much. So what experiments are testing in the next 10 years maybe is up to this range. So they test these potentials up to a percentage level of fine tuning. And it seems kind of reasonable, at least to me, that we find something. R could be 10 to the minus 50, but then you would have to have some kind of very huge fine tuning here. So it seems somewhat natural, hopefully, that they will expect something. Also, from a theoretical point, the models we are building, they seem to be very simple, very straightforward. So hopefully nature has realized one of those, and experimentalists will discover something. Now, there's another reason why people are very excited about these experiments right now. And what the experiment actually testing is not directly epsilon and eta. They can't really see the potential. What they see is these small fluctuations. So I have already shown you in the temperature, you have this variation of temperature at the level of 10 to the minus 5. These variations in temperature arise because the scalar field kind of fluctuates a little bit. And that means that inflation at certain points ends in certain points in space ends a little bit earlier, at other points a little bit later. And that generates kind of density waves. So certain points in space-time are more dense than other, and they will be the seeds for our galaxies and everything else. But there's, of course, something else that fluctuates, and that's the metric. So there are also gravitational waves in the metric that can be observed hopefully in the future. So these indirectly observed. That's what I said at the beginning. They can't be directly observed, but these gravitational waves and the density waves, we understand them theoretically very well, and they leave an imprint, a particular kind of signal in this cosmic microwave background that we observe today. So we can look for these imprints, and that is what experiments are doing right now. They're looking in particular for an imprint of these gravitational waves. So it would be an indirect measurement of gravitational waves, which we have already, but would be nice maybe to have another one. But there's more excitement, something much cooler that experiments can discover here. So how to discover this? These gravitational waves, they leave a particular kind of polarization. So mostly experiments so far, they just looked at temperature fluctuations, and the photons are usually unpolarized mostly, and then you need to look very closely and you see some kind of residual polarization. This polarization can be curl-free, some E-modes, and they can be divergence-free, which is called B-modes. And only gravitational waves could imprint such a signal of polarization on this cosmic microwave background. And we just reached this kind of threshold where this search for this polarization, for this particular imprint, becomes comparable to other bounds. And becomes very interesting for theoretical model building. So this is what we just entered. And why is this so exciting? Because these gravitational waves called tensor modes, if they were to be measured, they tell us directly the scale of inflation. So this is the scale of inflation in Planck units. So if we measure the size of these fluctuation via this primordial B modes, we exactly know the scale of inflation. And stick to this parameter R, which I introduced once, which we keep the whole time, which is just 16 times epsilon b. It tells us directly the scale of inflation. In particular, you find 2 times 16 r over 0.1. And remember, right now, the bound on r is 0.1. So if they find r right now, the scale is 2 times 10 to the 16. And this is where the huge excitement comes from, or where I think the huge excitement for the whole string community should come from. We are super, super close to the Planck scale. We are at the gut scale. We can test physics at the gut scale. And future experiments can push R by 5 years, one order of magnitude, 10 years, two order of magnitude. But the scale of inflation, since this goes like one to the fourth, is still essentially the gut scale. So whenever these experiments find something in the next 10 years, the next 15 years, it will be inflation very close to the gut scale. And this scale is 12 orders of magnitude larger than what we can probe at LHC. So it would be the first time we have like access to such an energy scale. And as I will tell you later, this whole theory is very sensitive to even Planck scale effects. So that's where we are string theorists come in. Now, what you probably all heard, last year in March, there was a big hype. BICEP detected B modes after like taking data. So at the South Pole, the days are six months long, and the nights are 6 months long. So if you have the night shift, you're pretty screwed. But so they took like three nights data for 3 years, and they claimed the detection of B modes. And shortly after, people analyzed the data and the foregrounds in particular. So essentially, the light travels from 380,000 years until today. So it travels for 13 billion years. And if you don't look very carefully, how do you know it's really the light that comes from 13 billion years versus something much closer, some kind of foreground emission? And that's what I want to discuss right now to clarify what happened there. So in particular, the foreground everybody worried about is dust. Dust is some carbon or something else, some kind of small pieces that have a temperature maybe of 20 degrees. Maybe they have multiple black bodies. So I plotted here a black body of 20 degrees. So this is 2.7 Kelvin. This is 20 Kelvin. It peaks at 1,000 gigahertz. This peaks at 150 gigahertz. And what all these experiments do, they look at one particular frequency in the sky. So they look like this. And if you only look at one frequency, it's of course impossible to tell whether you really see the black body at 2.725 Kelvin. And why they believed they would see the black body is that people estimated dust to be very small. And then there was the whole story, if you have been following it, that Planck hasn't released this data at other frequencies, but they had shown some plots, so they went and took the slide, and then they rastered the slide, and from the slide they tried to reproduce the data, and from that data they then got the hope that actually dust is very small as they expected, but they didn't really have the data to say anything for sure. So they didn't really know whether what they see here at this 150 is some kind of dust, which is very large, or it's really this primordial black body spectrum. And now there are a variety of experiments. So CAG also is releasing data, and Planck certainly has released the data, and Planck as a satellite, they can go to much higher frequencies. So from the ground, once you go to higher frequencies, you want to go past 150 because then this black body goes down while the other one keeps rising. So that's where you can really easily distinguish them. And Planck can do that. Planck goes to 350. But from the ground, this becomes very dirty. So you have problems with the atmosphere and things like that. So Planck, on the other hand, is a satellite that was planned like a long time ago, and by the time it goes up, they are not as up to date as these BICEP detectors. They are not as sensitive, so they couldn't really say for sure either what is going on. So they paired up Planck and BICEP, combined their data. So this is what the current status is. I think past that, nothing was really released on polarization. So BICEP has this data at 150, and then Planck at 355, where the black body should go really down, and then there's also CAG at 150. And then depending on which of these experiments you combine, this is this R value. So I said it's right now constrained to be around 0.1 or something from other observations. But BICEP, CAG, and Planck, which is this solid black curve, they find that it peaks at 0.05. However, this zero is also with 0.4, not that unlikely. So there is no, what they had before, like 5 sigma detection or something. Right now, zero is still within reach. And if you combine only Planck with CAG or Planck with BICEP, you find slightly different curves. But so right now, the status is it peaks at 0.05. But I mean, it's nowhere detection. It's no clear signal. So the question is, what is next? What is coming up in the future? So here I took a slide. I don't know who was at Stringfino. I wasn't there. So I took a slide for Stringfino from somebody from CAG. So they are releasing soon 220 gigahertz data. And what he showed here, what are the possibilities? Assume there is a signal of R equals 0.05. Then this curve that I showed you before that peaked at 0.5 and went down to 0.4 would go down to point whatever, 1 or even less. If the signal, however, is closer to 0, then they would find this green curve. So these are kind of the predictions. So we see that they will substantially improve if R is non-zero, if R is large, 0.05. If it's smaller than zero, they will also clarify that. So this frequency will help a lot, and if you look at this talk, he said the paper will be out in a few months. So I was at Stanford like 2 weeks ago, and I talked to one of the postdocs, and I said, oh, this paper is out in a few months. I talk in September. Will it already be out? And she's like, no, the paper will be out in a few months. So it seems like a time translational statement, but she said there's a lot of activity going on, and people are excited about writing this up. And I mean, at least here in writing, they said it should be out by 2015. So we hope that this comes out soon and might tell us a little bit more what R is actually and what the energy scale is and which models are favored. Now, in addition to BICEP and CAG, there are many, many, many more experiments. So there are a lot of ground experiments that are going on, being planned. There are balloons that are flown on the South Pole, and there are also satellite planned for the 2020s. So Japanese is most advanced in terms of funding and stuff. They have some level A, whatever that means. Then there's PIXIE, is the US, and then the ESA, they have some concept which they call CORE, Cosmic Origin Explorer. So none of these are funded for sure, but I mean, it seems very likely that in some kind of combination, maybe they work together or something, a satellite will be flown again by the 2025 or something, 2022, depends on it. So for sure, we expect a lot of interesting data coming in for the next 10 years, next 15 years, potentially. There is no kind of threshold we reach, like at LHC, where it just gets so expensive it's very difficult to build more and more machines. Here, it's still very cheap, and experimentalists can still build a lot of machines and bring in a lot of very interesting, exciting data. So there's a lot of exciting time ahead. Now let me give you some few words on why we as a string theory community should get into this, what can we contribute, and what are some challenges. And then I will review some kind of explicit models. What Lies, I'm not sure how to pronounce it, and people pronounce it differently, has shown is if this R value is measurably large, then we face two challenges. On the one hand, inflation, as I said, happens very close to the gut scale, which is super cool because we've never reached such high energy scales. But it also brings challenges, as I will show you in the next slide. The other thing is that the inflaton moves over a large field range. So schematically something like this. So the inflaton moves in field space on this flat potential very far by a distance that is larger than M Planck. And this is something where string theorists can have something to say. So let me start with the first point. If we have inflation at this scale of 10 to the 15, 10 to the 16, then it's not easy to build a model in string theory. So we clearly have the Planck scale at 10 to the 18, 10 to the 19, and below the Planck scale, if we want to have some control, we want to have weak string coupling, we have some string scale, and if we compactify some kind of 10-dimensional string theory, we have a KK scale. So we need to somehow fit those in and make sure the universe stays four-dimensional up to this energy scale. Then usually if you do compactification of string theory, you have a lot of extra fields. You don't just have one inflaton that nicely rolls down at potential. So you kind of need to keep track of those. Even if they are heavier than Hubble, it might often be interesting to keep track of them. And they can be very useful. This was shown by those people that they can have some effect on the potential of the inflaton itself that actually helps with fitting the data in a nice way. I will give one example below. And lastly, when you know you're really in deep water and you're really in trouble, you really need to worry about factors of 2 and 2 pi here. So if you forget some factors of 2 pi in your compactification and you have 6 dimensions, if you take 2 pi to the 6, it's like 60,000. So if you only have like 2 orders of magnitude of room here, you really need to be careful. But I mean, it can be done, no doubt about it. We all got factors of 2 right and wrong, I guess. But if you just double check and have enough students, it's no problem. The thing why we should get excited, why we should say something here, string theory community, I think, is this a large field range. So during inflation, during the 60 E folds, this inflaton field moves from, let's say, its minimum or any other point, a distance that is comparable to M Planck or even larger. If R is 0.1, it's 0.01, even if it's 10 to the minus 3, I mean, this is still comparable to M Planck. So if you have this kind of scalar potential, this function that gives inflation, and you expand it, you find a lot of corrections. And all of these corrections are at least suppressed by Planck scale. So let's assume the highest scale that can be there is the Planck scale. So you have Planck suppressed operators. Now, how do you calculate Planck suppressed operators? You need a UV complete theory of quantum gravity, which we have. So as string theorists, we can actually check this. And maybe the example with the shift symmetry is slightly different, but their one also has a lot to say from string theory. So whenever you expand it, you have an infinite number of operators that you kind of need to control. So here, I think it's very useful to have string theory as a tool at hand. So here I put this again, and yeah, so it's usually very difficult to forbid these operators, because if I write down some phi to the 6, and I can, the kinetic term is phi squared essentially, why can't I have phi to the 6? It's very difficult. The only exception with the shift symmetry, as I say, I'll discuss later. So in a UV complete theory of quantum gravity, we can actually check this corrections at least to some degree and can say, yes, they're all small, or no, they destroy inflation, or they matter. So we really have something to say, and we bring something to the table that nobody else has. And the experimentalists, I think, they are happy to see all these string models, and they put it in their plots, and they're essentially checking them. So this is very nice, very satisfying in this field. Now, having this kind of UV complete theory of quantum gravity, like string theory or something, is not necessarily sufficient. If you write down any potential, usually all these CN coefficients are all large, your potential looks like crazy and it oscillates a lot over Planck scales and who knows what, maybe some other direction here becomes flat, maybe the inflaton starts coupling very strongly to some other field. A lot of things can happen. So how do you get around this? What we really want is something which is very flat, very smoothly over distances that are large compared to M Planck. And there the trick, the idea everybody uses is to use some kind of shift symmetry. So essentially in string compactifications, we can have hundreds, we can have thousands of moduli, and you pick one and you move it by a very huge distance, and you want all the other one ideally to stay still. So that only works if you have some kind of underlying shift symmetry. So in string compactifications, half of these fields would be axions. These axions have a shift symmetry, which we can then use to build models, and which is what is usually done in. Now, there is a lore that any theory of quantum gravity shouldn't have any kind of continuous shift symmetries. It's based on black hole evaporation and things like that, and it seems to be respected by string theory. So in string theory, any kind of field with a continuous shift symmetry at the classical level will have some kind of broken discrete shift symmetry, usually once you take into account non-perturbative effects. But this symmetry is still sufficient and still very useful for inflation. So I like pictures, as I said. Yes, this continuous shift symmetry, the potential can change because you can shift the field by whatever you want. Now, discrete means you have these oscillations. You have essentially a cosine potential, and there is some kind of decay, axion decay constant that tells you the periodicity. And this is the first class of models I want to discuss next, the first class of inflationary models that one can build here. And so let me get to this next point, building models. We have seen before that this kind of potential has a certain discrete shift symmetry, and there's this parameter FA, the axion decay constant, that tells you the periodicity. And these models actually fit here into the data. And this band arises because FA is a continuous parameter. So depending on how you dial FA, you move up and down this band. And the width arises because we don't really know how reheating works after inflation. So depending on how the universe gets reheated, we might need 50 E-folds, which are these smaller dots, or 60 E-folds, or something even slightly different from that. But so that's why people plot a certain width. And then here we have one free parameter in these models. And we see they cut here through the two sigma regions. So they are certainly very interesting experimentally. There's the models that are currently being tested that might be excluded in the future, that might be confirmed in the future. So that's why I chose this model. Another model that cuts right through this region is some kind of polynomial potential. So we see some polynomial power, phi to the square, phi cubed, phi fractional powers. We also see it cuts right through the data, and these are models, so this is probably excluded. This borderline, maybe, these are still in the two sigma region, will be tested next. So those are the models I also want to discuss. Now, if experiments zoom in somewhere down here, then both of these would be unlikely. So there is a third class, this class of supergravity models, which are called alpha attractors. So those is the third class I want to discuss. And then, of course, here in the center, where this kind of comes out, there is another class of models are called Starobinsky models, R squared inflation, a very old idea. And Sergio is a world expert, and I'm sure he will mention this. So I won't, but stay tuned, it's coming up. So let's go back to this natural inflation models. So as I said before, these axions get this kind of discrete shift symmetry, so they have a potential that is essentially a cosine with a certain axion decay constant, which I call pi instead of A, I guess. There are some further higher non-perturbative effects, but usually you can neglect them, so they don't really modify your potential substantially. And that seems like a very natural candidate for inflation, and these whole models are called natural inflation. They were originally invented by those people, and then in the supergravity context embedded by this. There's a huge literature related to it, and I'll show you in a second, I think. So let's first look at the models a little bit in string theory. In string theory, it was noted in 2003 by those people that it seems very difficult to get this f pi larger than m Planck. In string theory, somehow you always seem to have corrections, and this f pi always seems to be slightly less than m Planck. However, in order to match the data, we need that f pi is larger than m Planck. Not by much, maybe a factor of 10. That's why I say here the factors of 2 pi and things that they really matter. So if we have f pi of this order, then it would be sufficient to be in agreement with the data, but we definitely need it larger than m Planck. And there were two ideas in the literature, two broad ideas which I want to review that kind of give you this possibility. One is due to Kim, Nilis, Peloso. They say, okay, one axion doesn't work. Let's take two axions. And for the same reasons as before, all of these kind of axion decay constants, 1, 2, G1, 2, they all have to be smaller than M Planck. And they take two kind of instanton corrections here. So everything is periodic with sub-Planckian periodicity. Now, what they say in the first page of their paper, if F1 is F2, F1 over F2 is G1 over G2, then we can define this A variable. And then the potential takes this form. This is the main result of our paper. So I'm like, okay, that is not totally clear to me what happened now. So let's plot a picture again. What you find, if these two values are kind of degenerate aligned in this particular way, then we have two cosine potentials for this value A, this diagonal direction. So we have the overlap of two cosine waves. However, this transverse direction is a flat direction. It's completely flat. There's no potential. And if you think about it in terms of the transverse field divided by some axion decay constant, this tells you if this axion decay constant is infinite, right? If this would be infinite, then A would drop. So here, essentially, in the transverse direction they have generated, they have found a mechanism to get an infinite axion decay constant. And if you don't align this perfectly, but you almost perfectly align it, you find that this transverse direction, this transverse here, has a very shallow, very small potential, which is very suitable for inflation, and which can have arbitrary large f pi. So you can have your 10 f pi that you need to match the experiments. So this is kind of their idea. You have one heavy axion, and then in the diagonal kind of, you generate one shallow direction, and you get this natural inflation model. There's another idea, which is called end inflation. Maybe generalization, depends on who you ask. So it's based on some early ideas about assistant inflation. And it takes a huge number of axions. So let's say 100 or 1,000, whatever. This we can have in string compactification. It seems kind of natural. And the idea is essentially Pythagoras. So if one of these axions can only be displaced a sub-Planckian distance, and the other one too, then the diagonal direction can actually get in some factor of square root of 2. And again, in pictures maybe plotted here. So here you have some kind of sub-Planckian axion decay constant here too. But here in the direction diagonal, you can get an enhancement. And if you have sufficiently many axions, you can get an enhancement by square root of n. So if I say if you have thousands, then you can get a large square root of n factor. And we don't need a huge number. In huge enhancement. That's what I said. Usually in string theory, we expect this f pi not to be much smaller than Planck. So if you get some square root n, we can get certainly this 10 m Planck. And this mechanism also works if these axions are not fully degenerate, if there are some kind of different, slightly different. And so there is a huge literature extending, complementing, checking, and so on, embedding in different settings. So I put a huge list here. Bert Van Ocker, who is here, wrote a paper. Wieland wrote a paper, Anna Achukaro, and many, many more. So it's a humongous list I started compiling. A lot of people, it's a lot of excitement, there's a lot of interest. But very recently, there was an issue raised which is somehow related to what's called a weak gravity conjecture. So these people in 2006, they conjectured that in any theory of quantum gravity coupled to any kind of gauge theory, like in our universe, gravity is the weakest force. So what does that mean? That means there has to be some kind of particle whose mass in Planck units is smaller than its charge. So that because the mass is coupled to gravity, gravity is the weakest, so the mass has to be smaller than the charge in Planck units. That is their basic idea, which they believe to have some black hole remnants, as the absence of certain black hole remnants should be the case in our universe, and it seems to be realized gravity is very weak in any quantum gravity, and in particular in string theory. And then there are two different versions where this particle with mass smaller than charge is the lightest particle there is, or it is not. And so there are weak forms of this weak gravity conjecture and then a strong form of the weak gravity conjecture. And people have kind of been using that to constrain the axion field range, the axion decay constant in string theory models. And there have been a lot of arguments for this and against this. So people build models where they get slightly above M Planck, but then other people say, okay, it has to be slightly below M Planck, and maybe there are some factors of 2 pi, or maybe there are some instanton corrections you didn't take into account. So it's going back and forth, and it is not quite settled, which is unfortunate. But as you can see, there's a lot of activity going on, and a lot of people are working on it, in particular Daniel Junghans, who will give a talk about this in the next morning session. So I'll refer you to this talk. However, I would like to mention, if you were at Strings, you might have heard that I wasn't there, but Juan Malacena is not working on it. But he talked about it for a few minutes. So he said it should be something that is of high priority for us. I mean, as a string, it seems a well-posed question. Can we have super Planckian axion decay constant, yes or no? And we should better figure this out before the experiments are done, right? If you do it in 10 years, the experimentalists tell you, oh, these models don't work, and then you say, hey, string theory tells us that it doesn't really work, would be kind of silly because it's already experimentally excluded. On the other hand, you have to tread very carefully. If you say, hey, string theory forbids this, we can't build any of these models, and suddenly the experimentalists find a signal here, then they would use it against you, right? And they would say string theory doesn't work. So you have to be careful, but we definitely need a much better understanding of this issue. Some people even raise the question whether we can get large R at all in these other models, but that I think is premature, this critic. So this kind of brings me to the next class of models, which are called axiom monodromy inflation. It's essentially a power law potential, and it kind of arises naturally in string theory. So as I said before, we usually have this discrete shift symmetry, and we can just break it. We break it explicitly by turning on some kind of potential for the axions, and then we get this kind of structure that repeats itself, which is very interesting. And in principle, these kind of wiggles can add some wiggles to this potential, which people also study and experimentalists actually search for in their data, but I won't go into that details where you have wiggles on your potential. But it's certainly an interesting feature and something the experimentalists can search for, so they're very excited to go through their data and see whether they see this kind of stringy effects. What we see here also, if due to this branch structure, if you go very far out on a branch, you can kind of fall down into another branch. So that also puts an upper bound on the field range in these models during inflation. So you can't get 1 million M Planck or something. I don't know what the bound is, but probably 1 million you can't. So in all models we checked, usually you can get sufficiently inflation, but you can't get arbitrarily large. So maybe this is also somehow connected to this, that string theory wants to tell us something. We can't get arbitrarily large field range, but we don't need it for these models or for experiments, to explain experiments. Yes?
Where is the slow roll part?
Sorry, where is the?
The part which is a smooth roll.
Yeah, so that okay. Yeah. So m squared phi squared, just a parabola, is smooth enough if you move out far enough. If you calculate this epsilon parameter, it goes like 1 over phi. So you have some V prime over V, and then I guess V prime, so it goes like 1 over phi squared M Planck squared. So if phi is larger than M Planck, this is epsilon. Sorry, yeah, this is in small. So it needs this large field range. Yeah, it's very deceiving, this picture I showed wrongfully. But M phi squared works. It's just at the beginning nicer to get the idea of slow roll. So these original models were proposed by Alexander, Ivar, Liam. There were different variants, some D4 brain wrapping some cycles, some NS5 brain in the bifid throat wrapping some two cycles that is connected. It's a little bit complicated. So there are a lot of papers on this, and I apologize, the one I'm most familiar with. I want to sketch in a few slides what I did, just to get some few ideas about these models. So I can show you there's a huge literature, in particular Dieter, so I wanted to mention this. So Dieter had two papers also in the context of these non-geometric fluxes and the non-geometric setup with T-folds, which I think is very interesting. There you can get interesting potentials, you can get new features that people haven't studied. So we had this whole huge discussion on Tuesday, and I think this is somewhat tied to this cosmology. It might have applications there, this whole double field theory, which kind of scalar potentials can you get there, can you use them for inflation? That's a very interesting story. Also Daniela talked about it yesterday, Diego is also here at the conference. And many, many more people worked on that. I just want to sketch now a couple of features in one model, which I took from here, which is no better than any other model. I'm just more familiar with it, and I just give you the very brief, basic overview in a very simple model. So if you know 10D supergravity, type  2A, type 2B, you know you have this kind of H squared term, which is essentially the DB2. And you have these Ramon-Ramon fluxes where P runs over odd or even numbers depending on whether you're type 2A or type 2B. In type 2A, we have a mass parameter. We can have massive type 2A, or in type 2B, we can have F1 flux, which would be this Q1. And then if you expand these tilde fluxes, you could get terms like B squared or B to the fourth. So if you remember B squared, it's very unlikely B to the fourth potential would be certainly excluded. So I get back to that later. In a second house, it's nevertheless very natural. So, and these arise, for example, in type 2B from F3 flux and F5 flux with some one flux turned on as well. You get this kind of quartic potential. Similar here from F5, you get quartic terms. So if you compactify this string theory, you find some kind of potential which looks like B squared plus B to the fourth, very naturally. Don't need to do anything. You have some kinetic term, and you get a B squared, and you get a B to the fourth. One thing which seems kind of surprising as an outcome, you get very naturally low powers. So you can't get B to the 15. You can't get B to the 100. You get maybe 2, 4, and maximum 6. Comes out very naturally as an upper limit here. For Ramon-Ramon fluxes, the upper limit would be B squared. And for complex structure and large complex structure limit, you would also get some kind of power to the 6 as maximum. Now, this whole analysis is completely independent of type 2A or type 2B or how you compactify and all your underlying theory details. It seems totally generic. It's always there. And then the question is, can we use that for inflation and what kind of predictions will we get? Okay, let me first answer the other, make a comment on the Planck suppressed operators. As I said before, in string theory, you have the possibility of checking Planck suppressed operators, and inflation is sensitive to these operators. So the question is, are these Planck suppressed operators there? So for example, if you break this explicit shift symmetry, we turn on some kind of F squared term, which gives us this, which is right here. Now there should be the same thing to a higher power as some Planck suppressed correction. Some alpha prime correction, there are string loop corrections. So that would give you something like this, and this would give you a much higher power. why can these be neglected? Can we maybe not turn them on? And the answer, I think, is usually no, there's no way. If you turn on this, then the thing squared should also be turned on. And so the answer is no. How can we nevertheless get some kind of inflation out of this? And there's a very nice trick here, which we have in string theory because we have the explicit setup. The NS-NS sector at tree level goes like 1 over G string. The Ramon-Ramon sector at tree level doesn't have this 1 over G string because there is some kind of rescaling we usually do it, like some Polchinski, in Tim Polchinski in the book. And this rescaling for the Ramon-Ramon fields actually tells you that all the higher f to the 2n, where n is larger than 1, they get some extra Dilaton suppression. So this already has some Dilaton suppression, and the higher ones, they get even more Dilaton suppressed. So if we are in a regime where we have a small Dilaton, we not only suppress the string loop corrections, but we also can suppress alpha prime corrections. So here we can actually say, okay, we have an infinite series of Planck suppressed operators, but all these coefficients are small. We can make them small, so we can trust this kind of tree level answers we have. Now, we have seen that this arises very natural, and we can have an infinite number of these dangerous irrelevant operators. And the question is, can we embed this in a full-fledged string theory? And there you find, if you move one field a lot, this is what I mentioned before, other fields start moving as well. And this is a good feature because we have these huge powers of p to the 4, which are experimentally. So I show you in one very simple example what you find. So you have some kind of prefactors, and you have two flux numbers, and you have the axion which arises from the B2 field, so I call it B, and you have one extra scalar field, the U. Now if you integrate out this U, which is stabilized, so it's stabilized by blowing up by zero and blowing by infinity, but if you solve the equations of motion for its minimum, you find that at its minimum it actually scales like 1 over B. So if you just minimize this, it's trivial. And then if you plug this in here, this goes like UB to the fourth. If you plug this in, you are left with only B to the cubed. So this is some kind of flattening. Once you start moving out the inflaton, other scalar fields start reacting and they flatten your potential and leading to a flatter potential and making you more compatible with the experiments. So you need to then ensure that U doesn't really mess up your cosmological prediction, so it needs to have a mass that is larger than H, and the kinetic energy can't be too large, and you can check that. And this is a very universal feature. You start with some kind of maximum power, P naught, which can be 4 or something, or 6 even, and then once you integrate all the other fields, once you set them to their minimum, you find that you end up with a much smaller power. And this much smaller power doesn't need to be integer, depending on how all these moduli appear. This can be fractional power, so you can find 3, 2, 4/3, 2/3, 1, whatever you like. And these are these models that the experimentalists plot here. So all of these are kind of constructed in string theory, embedded in string theory. You have power 2/3, you have 1, 4/3, you have 2, and you have 3. So 3 clearly is excluded. These models are currently being tested. So this is like a very exciting time that you can actually construct something. The experimentalists care about it, and they test them right now. They might be confirmed when Keck releases the next data. So this is something very nice and very exciting. Now, what happens if these kind of here on the right and these on the left get tension and are excluded? What can we do? You see there is a line cutting right through the middle, a yellow line. It's actually yellow triangles. And this is called alpha attractors, they call it here. This is a huge class of supergravity models, which originally are due to, I think, Sergio et al. And other people. So there are a lot of people working on these supergravity models, and I try to cite as many as possible. Reminds me, I forgot. So Marjorie also had a model related to this axiom monodromy with some brains unwinding. So there are a lot of nice string theory ideas, which I didn't mention on the previous slide. So there are a lot of models, and here also there are a lot of models and lots of recent activity. So Sergio had a lot of papers, Anna had a paper, Tuan had a paper. And what I'm talking about is one of these recent papers. I just picked one and wanted to present you the idea, what's going on, how does it work. And what do we get? Essentially, what we can get here is not just these lines, but we can essentially cover this whole range. And the basic idea is some kind of kinetic flattening. So this kinetic term is non-standard. You have this alpha parameter in there. And then if you go to a standard kinetic term, you find that your potential essentially depends on the tang of this canonical field. Now the tang flattens out very much, and that is very nice for inflation. So if you have a potential like a tang, and you just take a simple monomial, let's see, a monomial of this tang as your inflaton, then you find if alpha goes to infinity, this just goes to phi to the 2n. So if n is 1, it goes to phi squared, which was these yellow lines I showed you. However, for any kind of finite alpha value, if alpha is finite, we get a potential that very nice flattens and becomes very smooth and is very suitable for inflation. In particular, if alpha is small, what happens in these models, surprisingly, is this kind of n, the power, which previously was very important, which tells you about the potential, doesn't really matter. So you get kind of universal predictions, a universal attractor. So that's why these models are called alpha attractors. So what is shown here is for n equals 1 and large alphas. So here up here is large alpha. Down here is small alpha. So these kind of models, they fan out here and cover everything, which is not really plotted here because then you wouldn't see much else. And down here, they universally attract to some values down here. So, and then you can't really see that well on this scale, so you need to go to some log scale. So the same thing kind of plotted in a log scale without the experimental data, but the same axis is shown here. So we do log to the base 10 of R. And then here's again NS. So for R 10 to the minus 1, this is the current bound. And here you can see how these models fan out and cover the entire interesting range. So they are much better to, or they can explain essentially everything that the experimentalists will potentially see if it's at the level 10 to the minus 1, 10 to the minus 2. And then they have this interesting feature that they converge here on some other models. Now, how do you do that in supergravity? Not too complicated. You can just take two fields and then you can build these models. So I wrote down here Kähler potential, superpotential for n equals 1 supergravity. And the curious property is here that this alpha actually doesn't appear in the superpotential, in the scalar potential. It appears in the Kähler potential as prefactor, and it's actually the curvature on the moduli space for this T modulus. As Renata said, there's also something Sergio noticed. So what you measure here, if you measure this parameter alpha, would be related to curvature of moduli space. So if you think in some string compactification, it would be the curvature of the moduli space. And if we do a Kähler transformation, this takes a slightly more complicated form. So it takes this form, and then we can go to some kind of canonical variable. So, I mean, we are moving towards the coffee break, so I put some slightly more complicated equations, and then we can all have a cup of coffee and digest this. Here, if you go to this variable, you find it takes this form. And why I put it is because here you see very clearly that this Kähler potential has a shift symmetry. So this phi is the inflaton. It doesn't appear here. It's the real part. Here only the imaginary part appears. So this Kähler potential is shift symmetric. So this is some kind of axion which is somehow protected from higher corrections. And then in these models, you have essentially still a lot of freedom by choosing these two functions, g and f. And you can accomplish a lot, which is way beyond what one could do in any kind of string theory. Well, it's beyond certainly what we can do in any specific string theory model, without a doubt. So we have the freedom to choose these functions and what people showed in this model. So if you take this particular field to be nilpotent, which will be what I'm going to talk about in the next section, it is possible to build simple models of inflation that cover the entire interesting NSR plane. They can end in a de Sitter vacuum with a tunably small lambda. And on top of that, they can choose the Suzy scale arbitrarily. So if LHC finds Suzy tomorrow, that would be no problem. If LHC doesn't find Suzy, you just bring the Suzy scale up. So within two scalar fields and these relatively simple models, they can accomplish all of these things. So that is something, no matter what the experimentalists find, we are well prepared. We have some kind of models here that could explain it. Now, this is kind of finishing the review, which hopefully is sufficient to take you all the way to February 2017 when we all meet again. And I think experiments won't get much further than these kind of models up here. I want to talk for a few minutes about something new, which is related to a nilpotent chiral superfield. So it's related to four-dimensional n equals one supergravity and of course also to cosmology, otherwise I wouldn't talk about it. So as you know, supergravity was discovered in 76 by Dan Friedman, Peter van Nienhuysen, and Sergio Ferrara, so he's older than me. And like 3 years ago, Tuan and Dan wrote this beautiful book which contains everything you ever wanted to know about supergravity, except what I'm going to tell you now, which didn't quite make it to the book yet, because it's kind of new. So what happens in global supersymmetry, which people knew for a long time, but the same holds in supergravity, is that there exists a standard chiral field with some scalar and some fermion, some F term, that squares to zero. It's called a nilpotent chiral field because it squares to zero. And then you can work through the equation, what does it mean that S squared equals zero? So clearly the phi squared has to be zero, and then you look at order theta, you get chi times phi. And then here at theta squared, you get phi times f, and you get chi squared. This has to be zero. And in particular, this you can just solve phi equals chi squared over 2f. So phi equals chi squared over 2f, and these are some two-component fermions. So it's the first and second component. If you multiply that by any further component, like here, this also vanishes. And clearly, if you square it, it also vanishes because it has too many powers of fermions. So this is a nilpotent chiral superfield. And I should also say, Sergei Kuchenko worked on this. He had a lot of papers on this. This is very interesting. It doesn't have any scalars. So the scalar is a fermion bilinear. It consists only of fermions. And why that works is that SUSY is essentially non-linearly realized. So it's spontaneously broken, and the supersymmetry transformation contain a constant shift, and then this quadratic term in the fermion chi. What Sergio et al. Last March noticed is how do you build like some kind of supergravity model, just the bosonic supergravity part. S doesn't really contain scalars, but nevertheless, it contributes to the bosonic superpotential, to the bosonic action. So if you have this kind of scalar potential, since S squared is zero, we can't have any other terms, so S squared can't appear in the superpotential. You can just calculate your usual scalar potential and you find C1 squared, this coefficient, minus 3 C0 squared. And this is totally amazing because it's very difficult to get the Sitta vacua, to get a positive cosmological constant in supergravity. You need to have a lot of scalars. You need to make sure they all have a positive mass. You somehow need to find some minimum, needs to be stable. It's very difficult. Here, it kind of comes out for free. You get the C1 parameter. You just turn on C1. You can set C0 to 0. You automatically have the Sitta. And in this particular case, chi is then the Goldstein over, and it gets eaten by the gravity. So this has a lot of useful applications in cosmology. So if you have some model of inflation, it can very easily end in the Sitta. You just add this nilpotent chiral superfield. It helps you with getting the Sitta. It also takes away a scalar degree of freedom. If you want to kind of construct the Sitta, or if you want to stabilize something before, you needed extra scalar fields. Extra scalar fields, they can become unstable, they can move. So this is problematic. Okay, the screen just went off. Okay. So here it says I have 6 minutes. No problem. The scalar degrees of freedom disappear since it essentially contains only fermions. So you have less scalars. And this is also intrinsically connected to string theory. So if you just look at an anti-D3 brain and you project out through some orientifold projection the vector and the scalar degrees of freedom, you're just left with fermions. And these fermions are essentially this Volkov-Akolov fermion, and they give you this nilpotent superfield. And Tuan has worked that out. And and other people have worked on this. So there is a beautiful story that also connects to string theory, and in particular the KKLT uplift, which is an anti-D3 brain, which we didn't really know how to write in a supersymmetric language, can be written very easily in a supersymmetric language using this nilpotent superfield. So it ties in very nicely to cosmology. And what I want to talk about is something very recent. So I'm not making this up, but there's a lot of activity. This is just like the last 2 months. It's crazy. There are 8 papers. So if you have this nilpotent chiral superfield, how do you couple it to supergravity? What is the full-fledged fermionic action? How does it look like? And that would be interesting, for example, for particle physics or things like that. If you want to study reheating at the end of inflation, you need to know the fermions. You want a standard model and things like that. And this was very recently, like in March, studied by Tuan and his colleagues. How does this look like? And they termed it pure de Sitter supergravity. Since essentially you have no scalars, you essentially only have a de Sitter supergravity. And the action is fairly complicated, like most of these fermionic actions. But if you go to a particular gauge that you take this nilpotent superfield zero, the action reduces to this. And here you see again this kind of minus V. So you automatically have this term that gives you the sitter, and it's independent from the gravitino mass. So you can have a non-zero gravitino mass and the sitter, and they're both independent. So this is a beautiful story. And those people, they extended it by including a chiral superfield, and Renata wrote down some generic idea of how to generalize it, and we worked that out very recently. So we wrote down kind of close to fully generic supergravity action coupled to arbitrary number of vector and chiral superfields, and that I just wanted to show on one slide. The usual Lagrangian contains this graviton, and number of chiral fields and number of vector fields, and it's given in over 3 pages spread out and 13 equations in this beautiful book by Tuan. And now you can ask what happens if one of these fields is actually nilpotent. And then we thought it's impossible to calculate because it's so complicated and this action is not trivial, but it turns actually out the action in the Lagrangian is still very simple. So it's exactly what's given in Tuan's book. You just evaluate the first one at this value, which is a fermion bilinear. And then all you get are corrections that are quartic in this superfield, in this nilpotent chiral superfield. So if you don't care about higher order corrections that are quartic and fermions or higher, you just evaluate the book at this, and that's what you get. And all we assumed in this kind of calculation is that the scalar potential doesn't have linear terms in S and S bar. If you assume that there are linear terms, and the calculation gets more complicated, and potentially the whole expression gets more complicated. That is not clear yet. So this is something that is going on right now that I find personally very interesting. And as you've seen, there is a lot of activity related to that. Okay, so this was something new, and the rest was overview. And now let me come to the conclusion. The main point I want to get across is that string theory is very, very useful for understanding inflation. So we have experiments going on. We can provide them with theoretical models, and they test them. And there are oscillational features they can see in the power spectrum depending on your model, and they actually look for those. So the experiments, I talked to Francois Boucher, he's like very excited. It's crazy, we can look for this, and we do this, and I never thought we would look for this, but now it comes out of the string theory models. So the experimentalists, they're really excited about these theoretical models we built and the different features they predict, and in particular if they can test it, of course. And if primordial gravitational will be detected in the next few years, then inflation took place at the gut scale, which is like totally cool because we suddenly have access to an incredibly high scale of energy. And at the same time, we have an unprecedented window on quantum gravity. So this is like 2 orders of magnitude maybe below the Planck scale. So we get super, super close to quantum gravity. Now, a nilpotent chiral multiplet, that's something I mentioned, has started to play a role thanks to Sergio's initial work. It became very important in cosmology. It has a lot of nice features. And I think we're still at the very beginning. So in the string theory context, how does it really appear, and does it appear in other places? And we are most certainly in the golden era of cosmology. So for the next 10 years, people are planning experiments next 15 years. So there's in the foreseeable future a lot of data coming in, and our models will be confronted with ever improving data. So it's a very exciting time to be a string cosmologist, and it's also not too late to get into it if you're a graduate student. The experiments keep going for a long time. Okay, so thank you very much.